this way.
Hi, everybody. We're going to get started.
All right. Hi, everyone. So as we're transitioning into the final panel, we're going to take a look at sort of the way Susie had prefaced it, a new avenue in which you can explore playwriting. Today we have Seth Cotterman moderating the panel, and we have three people representing two different groups of radio playwriting. And Seth, if you'd like to take
it away. Yeah, sure. Hi, everybody. I'm Seth Cotterman. I'm the manager of online media at the Dramatists Guild. Next to me is Claudia Catania, who is the host and producer of Playing on Air, which I just have to tell you, I'm a huge fan, and I recently got into it, and I put them up there on my iPod, and I listen to them on the way to work. So I'm a huge fan. And then we have Sheila Cowley, who is the, operations manager and writer and operations manager at WMNF in Tampa.
Oh, you're good.
To help me memorize the WMNF. And then Matt Cowley, who's a writer and sound designer at the Radio Theater Project and at Studio at 620. Okay, I was trying not to look at my notes. I did okay. Can I open up with just a general, what drew you into wanting to produce radio plays?
I work at a radio station. about 16 years ago, I started a radio theater troupe there. So I was a writer and didn't really have experience writing scripts, and I wanted to try it. And so we went to the Midwest Radio Theater Workshop, which is now the National Audio Theater Festival, so I learned a lot about the logistics of it. I think I would just start by saying, you know, nobody's talking about slamming doors and fibromyalgia and Molly and anything. You know, this is all new work. It's modern. It's not recreations of nostalgic stuff, but it's all new writing, and you know, it's relevant. It's not weird. It's just another mechanism. You know, it's another outlet for new playwriting.
I think the genesis for me was a little different, and I think there's room for a huge amount of writing and playwriting to go on to radio stations and podcasts and streaming and whatnot. But my niche, what I do and what compelled me to do this was it bothered me that we live in a big nation and the vast majority of us do not know a thing about theater. You know, maybe they've been to their nephew's high school performance or an occasional outing, but for the most part, I've done unscientific research and I've asked people if they can name a living playwright, and maybe they'll come up with an Albee or Kirchner, but maybe not. So I thought this is appalling because we have a treasure of playwrights and a nation that really doesn't understand very much about theater. So one day I was sitting at a reading in New York, you know, one of a multitude of readings, and once again a bunch of actors and playwrights, you know, blew my socks off, and I thought, why is it just eight of us on folding chairs listening to this person blow our socks off? Why not the nation? Same amount of time, why not? So I decided, there's a big waste. I don't like waste. I have an aversion to waste, and there's all that talent in New York. So I also thought if we could somehow, you know, create a platform that's essentially a stage as, you know, as large as airways can go and as ubiquitous as the internet, maybe more Americans would start to understand what theater's about and as a result become, you know, patrons. And you know, in terms of audience development, this might be a long-term way to gain support for theater as a whole. So it seemed the way to get into most people's lives was either through radio or the internet, and that the way to do it, at least in my estimation, was through the short play genre. Because people are on the go and they're used to consuming those particular old and new forms of technology in short spurts, which is perfect for the short play, whether it's 6 minutes or 26 minutes, it's still the amount of time they're used to consuming theater, music, discussions, whatever, on technology. And it's a genre that I think is magnificent and has tremendous potential, but is unexploited. So it seemed like a perfect thing. And given there's no money, there's no way you could really compete for, anything but something languishing in somebody's hard drive or drawer. And that's how it happened. So I just decided to do it. And the first person I called was Chris Durang, and he was really nice, and he said yes. And then Alexandra Thurston said yes, and Jan Reingold said yes, and it was enough yeses to put together a demo to take to a radio station, and that's how the ball got rolling.
So it's two different approaches.
So it's very different.
Yeah, you're doing studio work that you're distributing. We're doing, we've done a lot of studio work and stuff that we've distributed at other stations, but what we've been focusing on the last 5 years is live performances.
Could you both kind of talk about your process of producing? Because it is a little different. Can you talk about what goes in behind the scenes and how you put this all together?
Sure. So what we do for the past 5 years, part of this project is called the Radio Theater Project. And it started out as a collaboration between an art space in St. Petersburg, the studio at 620, which is a great little incubator art space for all kinds of things. And they say the answer is always yes. So there's theater and music and dance and anything else, and our radio station, WMNF, which is a community listener-supported kind of station. There's kind of a group of people there. We live in St. Pete, so there's a lot of retirees. And some of them in the community there are kind of have had long and storied theater careers, for instance, but are not acting actively anymore. So this was a way for them to kind of create opportunities for themselves. So what we do is once a month, for about 6 months out of the year, we do a live show, and it's usually three plays, two to three to four plays, actors in front of mics, and then there's a table of sound effects and things. We have about a day's rehearsal, come up and do, they do a read-through, and then we do a tech rehearsal in front of the mic with sound effects, and then just put it up the next day. So it's a very short commitment for the actors. I do a little bit of kind of pre-production sound effects stuff that weekend or whatever, the weeks before.
It's a Monday night, so right. A lot of the actors are in current shows, but the theaters are dark on Monday, so we get really good actors who are free on that night.
Okay. So, and we just record those shows and then broadcast them later on the radio station.
And we got a couple, the audience is built slowly, but now it's kind of standing room only. It was helped a couple years ago when we got a grant from the Florida Humanities Council to always include a Florida writer in the show. And because of the grant, it had to be free, so a lot of people started coming. But the last year, we haven't had the grant, and it's just been, make a donation at the door, and it's done really, really well, and it's gotten even more popular. And I would just say, you don't have to have a radio station to do this. We have a radio station with a bunch of microphones on this. You've got a studio. It's the kind of thing, if you don't have a radio station, it's you can still put work up with actors, reading scripts on mic for an audience with sound effects. You can record it if you want or not. I mean, there's a group in New York that sell out multiple evenings of shows, the same show, multiple performances, and they don't even try to record it. They're doing it just for the house audience. And things changed for us because we first were doing it to focus on the recording. And then we realized more people are in this theater than are probably listening to the show on the radio. The whole focus has become the house sound. And, we've kind of, I know you have kind of southern sound effects, and we've kind of ramped up the sound effects because, and made it a little more prominent. And I use manual sound effects more than recording.
Right. We started doing the radio theater in the studio, so I did all the sound effects on the computer later, kind of as a post-production sound kind of process thing. But we discovered that people just love watching me open and close doors and walk on things.
That's great.
So, as much of that stuff as I can do manually, that's just part of the show now. So.
I'm so glad that you threw that in, because I don't want to assume that everyone knows what a sound designer does, but if you could elaborate a little bit of your process, and then we'll go into what playing on air is and how it's different. But
sure.
I just don't want to assume that everyone knows what it is.
Sure. So the short answer is it's anything but the voices on a radio play. You know, if it, on a film, it's a whole different thing working with other stuff. But for us, it's just anything but the voices. But the kind of slightly longer answer is that the cool thing about radio for me is, like I think Steve said yesterday, that in a film, if you have, you know, Poland 1945, it has to look like Poland 1945. But on the stage, you can put a sign and people will buy into it. On the radio, you can say it's Poland 1945 and have a little bit of wind, or you can say, isn't the submarine great, and have a little ping sound. And in the listener's mind, they will see the complete set. You know, they'll see Das Boot in front of them, even though you haven't, you know, built it. So what I do kind of as a sound designer and Foley guy thing is kind of just push them in that direction. I give them just enough sound other than the voices to say, okay, this is really where this is, and grounds it a little bit. So if they're in a diner, I might clink some glasses, so it just makes it feel a little bit more realistic.
Right.
If there's a fight, you know, I have a little leather jacket filled with pillows that I fight with. Or if it's, you know, something that I can't do manually, there might be a battle sound, and that's computer on the computer. And it's just anything that pushes the audience to be their own cinematographer, in a way.
I would just say, as a corollary to that, I know one thing Steve Yockey said, if he's here, is I can never write for radio because my stuff is so visual, but I think, oh, that's the huge freeing thing of radio, because you can do stuff on the radio and create these visuals that you could never do on stage, and that, you know, maybe you'll never get a chance to do on film or television, but you can really do it easily on the radio. I would just mention The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Universe, or the Galaxy, which was this huge, beautiful world on the radio. And then in TV and film, it's just like a real letdown, you know. But it was written originally for radio. That's what it was created for. And something like that, you can do, I think one of your famous first ones was Carnival in My Pocket. Do that on stage, you know. You can do it on radio.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. And I can attest to the entertainment value of Matt's sound, because I was at a table with him, and he was doing the sound effects for Sheila's play. It was great. And also, when Michael was talking earlier today about animals and this and the other, and it is true, you know, we did a Warren Light piece called The Final Interrogation of Ceausescu's Dog, the Romanian dictator's dog, and Ed Asner played the dog. And it was, I think, for the listener, a lot more fun than, you know, because they could add their imagination, and that happens in a lot of the plays. Someone mentioned Jackie Rheingold earlier too, and she has a wonderful, fervent and whimsical, delightful sensibility. So she can write a play about a 12-foot guy sitting on an airplane next to a 2-inch lady, and on the radio, no problem.
Is there something that really attracts you to a script that you're like, this will fit really well? Or this will not fit very well?
I suppose. I mean, since this is more about theater on the radio than radio plays per se, you know, I look for a well-made play. that would be the first thing that would attract me. And I guess the last thing that would attract me too. I mean, it's basically that. It's just a good play. There are certain things that I know won't work, even if I adore the play. If it's highly physical and highly, highly visual, or it has an FCC infraction every second word, you know, those that can be problematic. But little adjustments. I mean, I've actually been quite amazed myself how little has to be done to a stage play to make it work on radio, and quite wonderfully. You know, yes. If there's, you know, 5 fuckins and 2 shits, that's generally not a big deal. And every playwright has a different way of, you know, dealing with it. But to a person, they've all said, oh, no problem. And they either cut it, or they come up with something even funnier instead of, or they just, you know, all right, I can't say fuck, I'll say screw. I can't say shit, I'll say crap. You know, whatever they decide to do, it's usually quite inventive and easy and fast. Sometimes, you know, there's a missing visual, and playwright is, you know, just, okay, you have a gun, you know, and you're done. It's all settled. Almost always the playwright's on site. So very often, last minute, you know, they'll say, oh, no, no. And they'll just rewrite a little something, and it's wonderful to watch them work because they just make a slight adjustment and it just kind of reshapes the whole moment. So we've been fortunate.
Awesome. Is there something that as writers, is there something that you have in your head that is, this is what we have to do? I noticed on your website that you accept submissions.
We do. I guess you accept submissions too. We both do. And we do.
But I noticed that you have like a list of like, keep this in mind.
Yeah,
playwrights.
Well, and that's a good point because we've had a different experience with adapting stage plays and some spectacular and infamous failures that live in people's horrifying memories of stage plays that people didn't.
Louder, please.
Stage plays that people didn't want to change anything. It's where we've run into trouble because a lot of stage plays work fine on the radio. It's all about dialogue. And where we've had problems is somebody said, oh, it was produced already, you know, it's a fully play, it was produced. It's fine just like it is, you know, I don't need to change anything. And what we found is it's a whole different medium.
Yeah, and that's an approach that we differ a little bit from people like Claudia, where she's putting a stage play on the air, and what we try to do is make radio plays, so that's a different medium. When I'm writing for that, what I try to do is take advantage of things that are specific to that medium. So things that you can only do with sound, or things that are enhanced by the use of sound, or things that have not worked have been things that are visual, obviously, or kind of, you're asking a lot for people to kind of sit and listen for a long time. So length is an issue, and there has to be something really compelling. So just like any other stage play, story is, you know, key. And there has to be enough action, even if it's two guys talking in a bar, to use the frequent analogy. There has to be something to keep the action going, to keep them listening. But so things that I've tried to do are, you know, just anything that's, there's an example I think of visually, like in the silent movies, there's scenes in like Charlie Chaplin where he's walking down a train track and there's a train behind him and he doesn't hear it because it's a silent movie, and so, you know, he just keeps walking, or there's a crowd behind him with signs and things and he doesn't notice because it's silent. And you can do that kind of thing on the radio, kind of in the inverse. You can and I'm suddenly drawing a blank because people are staring at me, but you know, things that you don't see, you can take advantage of the fact that you can't see it and kind of reveal it later, or things like
that's
that.
That's true. Things that only work because people can't actually see what's happening.
Right.
You know, it's a beautiful use of radio.
So I've written little short things that are on walkie-talkies, or people talking on the phone, or, you know, anything that is kind of a way that might not work on stage very well, but works because it's a sound thing. Mm-hmm.
But I think you asked about the mechanics of it, and, you know, some of the simple mechanics are, people have to talk or they disappear. You can't have people standing around in the background of a radio scene because they're just not there. So,
right.
So mm-hmm. there's, the fewer people that are in a scene, the easier it is on listeners. Two or three, four people, you know, once you get beyond that, it starts becoming a little chaotic for people listening. And there's not as much of this if you're focusing on people watching. You know, but on the radio, if it's truly on the radio, there's only so many people you can tell apart really at the same time, which is the old kind of classic, you know, there's on the radio guy, there's an Irish guy, a Jewish guy, a German guy, you know, they're all, so you can tell their accents apart, a Russian guy. So you can differentiate. And then you talk about casting actors from their tone of voice. You can't have people that sound identical, or they, it's like you've got the same person, like you've got twins on stage.
YouTube.
But, I'm sorry.
No, I just say that I find YouTube's very helpful, because you can't quite remember an actor's register. It kind of refreshes your memory, but I've made mistakes nonetheless.
Well, one of the things, it's really freeing. Yeah, it's really freeing because it doesn't matter how old you are, doesn't matter what you look like. You know, you never get cast in that part visually, maybe, but it doesn't matter because it all is what you sound like. And so you can have, you know, in your 70s playing beautiful young women. It's how they sound, you know. It doesn't matter how tall you are. You know, so actors really love it.
Yeah. Do you have questions?
I'm curious in your situation, if you mic your audience so that you're, they become a part of that process.
I think Sheila talked with Nan Barnett, who had a brilliant idea. They did some live stuff where they had the audience do some of the Foley effects.
You know, drop cue cards.
Right, which I think is great. But we do have a house mic sitting up to catch the reactions and things, because if you're listening to the live, to the broadcast later of the live show, that makes it just come to life a little bit better.
And clearly we're going to steal Nan's idea. Right. She said, mm-hmm.
Although one quick horror story that we saw sci-fi channel used to do radio plays for a while on their website, and they did a live show of Dial In for Murder and another play. And at the end of the other play, I think it was, they were in this field, and this tension was just building and building. It was really scary. And finally, the guy at the end did end the other guy with a shovel to the head, basically, right? There's this big scene building up and building up, and the Foley guy, doing everything live, has a big watermelon, and the shovel to the head is, boom, I'm smashing a watermelon. So if you're listening on the radio, that's a really scary moment until the crowd in the theater sees basically Gallagher, right? And so the crowd erupts in laughter.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah.
Hold up a few cards.
Please, actually, if any of you are in New York, we also started to do it occasionally in front of live audiences. And I don't know, I don't think we have time, but I did bring a sample if we do have time.
Oh, good.
Yeah. Some of the audio,
no, for
some
sure.
of the videos.
Yeah. And
we should do that.
And I would just say, if you're doing it yourselves, you know, actors are fantastic to work with on mic. There's basics of mic stuff, and we have an incredibly intricate handout that we neglected to print out that we can email, or you can email the people. It has a lot of resources for people that are doing it live now. Like Ira over there, who we just met, who's getting paid to write radio drama. You've got, what, like 70,000 subscribers to your podcast, the Truth Podcast?
I just write it.
That's a ridiculous
It's another good podcast, I have to say.
Yeah, it's cool. The Truth Podcast.
Yeah.
Cool.
So, 70,000 people in the crowd.
If you divide that by 10,000, that's how many we have.
I think it's there's a tremendous potential for the sort of work that we're doing. And I think more and more people will do it because for a long time, you know, the glory days of radio were over. And it was vanquished by television and film. But now everyone is constantly plugged in. So there's a huge need for content. So I do think there's potential there.
Oh, I have a question.
Sure.
Do you guys have to work with AFTRA, or?
I work with SAG-AFTRA, yeah.
SAG-AFTRA. And what about you guys?
We don't, because we basically have no budget. I'm not an expert on this stuff, but we have a couple of SAG-AFTRA people in there.
And equity
people. We've never had a problem. Our audience is small enough, and there's pay is low enough. It's basically gas money, so. Maybe that's what the cutoff is. I don't know.
And they're reading, too. So many times, if you're holding the script, they only have to pay for transportation.
I guess that's a good point.
Gee, I should tell that to SAG-AFTRA.
Equity.
Well, that's not exactly the type of question I was going to ask, getting more toward whether you have any written agreements or licensing with the actors or with the playwrights to do this, considering that I'm assuming it's recorded for maybe future rebroadcasts. What do you do about licensing the rights?
Me?
Everybody.
In terms of the actors, it's negotiated by the union, and it's favored nation, meaning everybody gets the same, and the whatever back end is the same, and what's paid into, you know, health and retirement. It's just, otherwise I think I would, you know, commit harikari or sport. So that's done. And then it's just a question of whether the actor wants to do it. For the writers, again, it's essentially favored nations. Again, I'm a one-man band here, and it is what it is. There's a flat fee, there's a sharing in revenue, other if we should be so lucky to think of other forms of revenue other than radio broadcast. I thought, you know, going into this, that there would be income of, you know, some support from what are called carrying charges. It's what the public radio state. But when you're an independent radio producer and you're starting, and the program director or the chairman of the thing says, "Oh yeah, we'll air you, but we won't pay you anything." It's, you know, you have to weigh: do I want another 400,000 people, or do I want $26? You know. So it's, yeah, what are you gonna do? Like, once you're successful, it's a whole other thing, and you have leverage.
For us, what we do in the studio is typically stuff that we write or friends of ours write, and our actors are friends of ours, basically. And for the live shows, we do take submissions, and there's an agreement with the writer, and part of that agreement is just understanding that it's going to be podcast and broadcast live and things like that.
Yeah. And they get a small stipend. Some people have flown from California to come to the show.
Yeah.
But the nice thing is that, you know, we're recording it for broadcasting, so you actually get a permanent record of your play and a link on the website to the podcast that you can share with all your family and friends. You know, this is my play, and this is what it sounded like.
For our actors, it's mainly a core ensemble, but it's all, we're not blessed to live in New York like Claudia, so for the most part, our names are smaller, not to comment on their talent, which is great, but their names are not as big, so they're mostly from our neighborhood. So the contractual stuff is smaller, and we're also under the umbrella of a couple of nonprofit groups in Canada, of course.
Yeah. Both of you, I think, mentioned about length of piece. What's the average length of a piece? You said short play, is it around 10 minutes?
The average is between 10 and 20 minutes.
10 and 20.
That doesn't mean there aren't exceptions.
For us, we found for the live shows, we've done some that are like an hour and a half, and those are really hard to keep an audience in place for. An ideal length for us is like 2 half-hour plays and then a 10-minute play, or something like that.
With an intermission,
yeah. We've done with it kind of depends on what your target is. Like, there's a lot of people producing podcasts now, which is great, and so that's can be really variable. You can kind of, it's just what the story demands. If you're aiming for radio broadcasts, there are specific time lengths. Like, you're shooting for 53 minutes.
Right. Yeah, I mean, to answer you, I have to come in at a hard 53 minutes. So that means if I'm going to have 2 interviews and 2 plays or 3 interviews and 3 plays, you know, you have to, when you start to program, not only do you want it to be thematically, you have some sort of thematic contextual sense, but it also has to fit together in terms of minutes. And then on top of that, there's an episode intro and an episode credits, and then there's a play intro and credits for each of the 2 or 3 little plays. And then there's an interview after each of the two, three little plays. And then there's music composed for each of the 2, 3 little plays, and then sound design.
But what has worked also well for us has been playwrights who have taken, you know, full-length plays and adapted them for radio into basically 2 half-hour episodes that run with an intermission in between. And some of the really, really great ones that we've done have been that we did Marcus Gardley just this last year as part of the Rolling National Career with the LARC, from which the Well Runs Dry. We had done the last 2 years adaptations of his that were condensed down and worked because the whole full length stage play was just too much for a radio audience, but you can kind of get the essence of it.
I've also done a lot of really short plays on the radio, like 1 to 5 minutes. For a while, I was doing one of those a week for like 2 years, which is a great practice for me, and it's a great way to try out ideas. And since it's radio, you can kind of do everything yourself, so it's a great way of just making an opportunity for yourself.
I would just say, if you're doing it yourself and you're working with actors, and actors are fantastic. If they're stage actors, you may have to tone them down a little bit on that, so they don't just blow you into the next room. Because the mic is very intimate. But, you know, what we found is people that will act with their whole bodies, even though they're on microphone, your body affects your voice, you know. And if somebody just stands there and talks on the mic and doesn't ever move, it really affects their voice, and they don't sound as alive as if they're, you know, really good voice actors can move and still not be off mic. And that's just something, you know, as you're working with people, to keep in mind, it's okay to move. It's okay to shrink up your voice and, you know, all of those.
And it's okay to vocalize too.
Mm-hmm. Step in, you know,
whatever,
screen.
Because mm-hmm. you can't, as you said, you can't have those pauses or people think they've lost power. So some kind of vocalization or sound effect to fill it in if you must have it. But basically, Claret's been very good about, you know, letting it go. And, you know, if there's time to shift gears, there's a lot that can be done in post production, even when it's recorded live.
If there aren't any other questions, we're going to see a little bit about a little bit from each of these, what they do. Do you want to start with?
Sure, maybe then there'll be some questions. Are you going to do the video first?
Yep,
we're pulling it up right now.
Takes a couple minutes to warm
up. Where is this video from?
In March, we did two evenings of three short plays each at a fantastic new facility in downtown Brooklyn called Brick, Brick Arts House. It's just adjacent to BAM Harvey. And they have an amazing black box with bleachers that come out and a little U-shaped balcony. So if they're really every seat taken, they can get 230 people in there. But they were terrific. Their crew was terrific. And we had a lot of fun. So it's a long story. Why we did this is because we are on nobody's radar. And a playwright said to me, David Ives, Claudia, you know, you're never going to raise any money if you don't raise your profile. So he said, call a meeting. And I did. I called a meeting. Six playwrights showed up, and they all concluded that we had to do something live. So I said, but you know, that's going to cost a lot of money, and everybody just acted like they didn't hear. and I just, you know, put it together. But they were right. They were right, because it has helped, and I think we need to do it more. So this is one of those two nights. And then from the first night, I was able to cobble two of them together to make a show. From the second night, hopefully two. And then I still have some extras, because you always have hanging inventory. Sometimes it's there for these wonderful pieces could be stranded and orphaned for a year or two before you find an opportunity where they fit in thematically and in terms of the minutes.
Matt, are we good?
This is loud enough for you all to hear it. which one mics do you have? Given and muted?
Any questions?
I think when we had a conversation at one point, you guys have been able to get some funding from the state of Florida,
the Humanities.
That was great, right?
That was great.
So, yeah, that was done through the studio at 620, that art space, and it was for 2 years, and it was to fund plays either about Florida, basically. So they were...
Or by Floridians,
preferably both. And one thing that we found really works for us is locality. So even after the grant has ended, we have this kind of running series where there's a continuing story each time that's really, really hyper-local. It's based in that town, and there's I co-write it with a former newspaper writer who's very funny, but he also adds in a lot of political references to people. And
it's incredibly popular.
It's popular because people like to hear their town mentioned in the radio.
I have a question. Have you experimented at all with times of day that you program your show and what is or isn't more or less successful?
We have no control over that.
Yeah.
Well, I thought you were like, you know.
No, I mean, the program director. The program director controls that. And we've been on the digital side channel for a couple of years. So most people are either listening to the podcast or they're at the event. Most people are not listening to the actual live broadcast.
So
that's a good question.
The show used to be on the main broadcast channel on a Wednesday night or something. And now it's basically podcasted. We haven't really pursued promotion as aggressively as we should, which means basically at all. But it's difficult to get listenership, I guess. So.
Yeah. Focus has really been the live shows. Yes. Yeah. The live shows are what get local press.
Can I ask, so neither of these programs have sought have been put out as paid podcasts. This has all been either broadcast or offered free online.
Yes, except I'm glad you brought this up because I'm, you know, knocking my brains out trying to figure out how to bring in a trickle of revenue. And the concept is to deliver theater to everybody for free and on demand. So that will remain. When they're on radio for free, it's streaming for free, you can podcast, you know, a few at a time for free. But it did occur to me that if we had a store where people could access shows that weren't available at that moment for free, let's say there's 5 shows up for free or 5 to 10, or for some reason they wanted to download it, I was thinking we should probably do that, and I wanted to sort of ask what you thought you would, you know, would be a reasonable price to pay, because I'd like it to be inexpensive, but also...
I'm going through the exact same thing, because I'm working on an audio project, and it's trying to figure out how to price it.
Right, and also, you know, obviously there's nothing that would be at the store couldn't be somehow gotten for free.
Yes.
But some people, you know, just convenience and... it's worth paying something.
Yeah, our podcasts at the Dramatists Guild are all free. I'm from the school that you don't pay for podcasts. Money shouldn't come from the listener, it should come from sponsors. I just came across a lot of research about the pricing of how you want to do that and how you want to sell it. But there's even a few sites, and I can't cite any of them, but you can put your podcast into it, and you don't even have to edit. They'll do all the editing, and they'll cut in the sponsors that they think are more suited for your program.
Wow.
So, this is all via Google. I just don't have the are we ready for the video?
Matt, are we good?
Yeah.
Yes.
Also, you can always get it to this.
Yeah.
Because it is not all on this.
All right. Well, here is playing on air.
Can you pause that for a second?
Claudia up there? Yeah, Clem, she's here.
Sounds not good.
The right spot.
Mm-hmm.
Jam box is in pair mode. Wind pair.
My sexy boom box. Nice.
Now.
This is a David Lindsay
reel. Are we good now?
We should be.
Okay.
You got some business here with Connie. Yeah, I got some business. Now let me.
Uh-oh.
Oh. Yeah,
why are you lying, Mr. Dugan? You've been out on disability for 3 months. You have no work to go to.
Connie, that you?
Yeah, it's me.
Hey, come on, throw down the key.
Oh, you're don't you buy some shade, you dirty old pig? Connie!
Ah, you thought I was screwing her.
I wasn't sure.
You were jealous of me, man.
No.
Yeah, it was. That's funny. You know what?
What?
You don't look how I pictured you.
What do you mean?
I mean, the way she described you, you're not how I pictured
you. She described me?
Yeah, only not too good.
Why, what'd she say?
Well, she said attractive.
One day, I was out in the patio thinking about how I'm almost 26 and I'm out of work. And then I look up, and I see these little underwears. Like, from a girl. A woman, rather.
I noticed Bax looking at me the second day he moved in. I knew his uncle next door a long time.
You ever notice on girls, I mean women's underwear, how they got those little ribbons in the shape of a bow? That's cute. The guy that invented that, yeah, he's some kind of genius. You know, my mind started going and...
Everybody celebrates something when it's hot.
Do not. People sleep when it's hot.
Your people sleep. My people with picnic and all that. Should have never followed you out here. Forget it. I didn't start the play thinking I was going to write a play about recovering addicts. I was going to write about two damaged people that were desperately trying to connect in some way. And so the fact that one of them happens to be an addict and her friends happen to be an addict, that was just sort of the texture for the play. But really it was about these two damaged people that shouldn't connect, that were trying to desperately connect.
So Rosie, do you think Connie will call Benny?
Yeah.
John, you often work in one-person comedic shows. That you've written, like Ghetto Clown, The Freak, or Speaker Roma. Can you talk a little about the attraction or the challenge of doing someone else's comedy?
Doing my own one-man shows is being up there alone. It's a weird kind of lonely environment. This is so much better. It's so much better to have stuff to bounce off people and have them to share. I mean, it's a much more groovy thing. The one-man show, I love the storytelling of a one-man show more than anything, but it's a lonely racket.
What made it especially fun, Bobby? I mean, you look like you were having a great time.
Well, David's a really good playwright. He's a crafty playwright, and like, I think the play sort of masters the form. It's a short play, and within a short play, there are all these reveals. And that's really what makes it fun, you know? You know going in, it's a short play, and you're kind of wondering where it's gonna go, and it's unpredictable. And I think like all the little doors that are opened in the play make it for a fun experience. And so I like that your expectations are kind of thrown off, you know? You think a lot of things are gonna happen, and the opposite happens. You think they're gonna maybe connect, and they don't. And that's why I like it. And you know, obviously the crowd, you know, it works.
Claudia, that was Acorn by David Graziano, right?
Yes, it was.
Yes.
Well done.
We produced that play at Summer Shorts probably, it's been 10 years now, and we took it out into the school tour, the high school tour.
Yeah.
And the kids loved that play. They loved it. Yeah. So it's fun to see it like that.
Yeah. The audience liked it a lot too.
Yeah.
Charming.
Yeah.
You guys have some... I'll give it to you.
So I thought, as a suggestion, we could do a kind of live thing here. So we could do it.
Yes, please.
And I all weekend have been incredibly intimidated to do that. Having
get your summary in. Come on.
So I just need.
So much we
right. So I need for this one two actors. If you have any volunteers, it could be anybody.
One in the back.
Oh, that one. Get her.
Get her.
Get her. She's good. Oh,
nice. Did you want to?
Come on.
Yeah.
No pressure.
So, I think this is a good example of one of Matt's that he wrote that takes advantage of the fact that you can't see what's going on. And I would certainly encourage everybody to write for radio and use it, you know, instead of a constraint. How could you, you know, just take advantage of it? Because you can do things you can't do on stage or with people or anything.
Terry or Amanda,
genders
are not specific.
Do we need one more actor?
One more actor.
One more actor? Come on up.
So you'll be Terry? And I will grab my extensive sound effects kit over here.
He didn't break the door.
Okay. Foley
artist.
If you guys can hear okay, we won't bother with microphones or anything.
It smells good. Right.
With the celery.
We're stopped by Publix this morning. The only direction I'll give you is the last line is kind of cut off by celery.
Oh.
Might be the best direction you've ever had.
Right. It was.
Brilliant. Give me 1 second. I'm going to make a mess for the epic house cleaning.
Yeah, I got the first line. I know that one.
All right.
Okay.
Well, this is cozy.
Yes.
All tucked up like this.
Yes.
Shoulder to shoulder, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually fairly comfortable.
Not bad.
I mean, usually when I lie on my back like this, it's really uncomfortable. It hurts my lower back. But this isn't bad at all.
That's good.
It's padded just right, I think.
Thoughtful of them.
Yeah. Nice.
Hmm.
It's a pleasant sound. If you close your eyes and listen.
It is kind of nice. Relaxing in its way.
Exactly. Like listening to the ocean at night.
Or rain on a roof.
A tin roof.
Yeah, rain on a tin roof. I love that.
One of life's great sounds.
Indeed.
You know what that reminds me of?
What's that?
The Smithsonian.
Really? Why?
Ever been?
No.
It's great. You should go. They have a pendulum there. This big weight on a long, long rope in the middle of the building.
That's cool.
It's really amazing. I don't remember what it was supposed to show you, but it looks cool.
Neat. Of course, strictly speaking, that's not a pendulum.
No, it said so. I remember.
Not the Smithsonian. Up there.
Oh, right.
Sure. A pendulum moves in a bit of a circle, I think. That's more straight back and forth.
True. And, of course, the one at the Smithsonian doesn't have the big axe blade at the end.
I don't imagine.
I think it came to a point and drew lines in the sand or something.
Like ultimatums.
No, just circles.
Oh.
The other one in D.C. wasn't slowly lowering down either.
No.
It was just in one place. And you didn't have to get tied to a bench to watch it.
That's an advantage.
Not that I mind being this close to you.
Of course not. Nice of you to say.
Not at all. Still, it'd be nice to be able to move a little.
Escape, maybe.
If it came up.
Of course.
What do you think will happen when that lowers all the way down?
Well, it'll cut us right in two, I should think.
That doesn't sound fun at all.
No.
That's the sort of thing that would kill a person.
I think that's the idea, actually.
Evil geniuses can really be fairly unpleasant of a Sunday afternoon.
To a spy, at least.
Yes. Still comes with the job, I suppose.
Absolutely. And it's been nice spending the afternoon tied up next to you.
You mean that?
I do. I've always felt like there's been a distance between us, and I've never known how to cross it.
You wanted to?
Yes, I did.
I don't know what to say.
It took a mad genius to bring us together.
Life is funny, isn't it?
Isn't it just?
Well, I feel like I can die a happy man now. Thank you.
Thank you. It's been a...
Thank you guys so much.
And we can email the fabulous resources for reading.
And you'll be around for the rest of the festival. Thank you, everybody.
Final housekeeping for the afternoon. Another round of applause, please.
It's been wonderful.
I hope you all agree, and you can look forward to a lot of the information this weekend, which will go up on our website as well, so that you can have some of the resources to link back to what we've been doing. And also, please feel free to email us. You're going to be getting like surveys and stuff, but we'd really like to know what has worked for you and what you'd like to see more of. God forbid we do this again, but we may, we don't know. But really, this was great. And Seth, thank you.
Oh,
thank you.
If anybody wants to know when we release new episodes or whatnot, you can go to the site and put your name in the contact thing, and we won't bother you other than that.
So we are done from six. We're at six. Is that
yes,
right?
Yes,
here
yes.
We are. Okay. Be back here at 7:30 for cocktails and to start sort of chatting each other up a little bit and drinking, so that we can start enjoying the finalist plays that will be next. And the other thing I will tell you is this, because I think this might have gotten lost a little bit, and we'll probably repeat it later. But all of you who are at CityWrights as playwrights, although our submission process begins August 30th through September 30th, because you are here, you can direct